The topic of the second lecture is singularities. But before that, I want to give you more examples on Kleiman-Mori cones. Examples of Kleiman-Mori cone. So recall that the Kleiman-Mori cone is the closure of the one cycles, effective one cycles. Right? So this is the Kleiman-Mori cone. Okay, so this was the definition of the Kleiman-Mori cone. So sometimes it is called pseudo-effective cones because we are taking the closure. It's called pseudo-effective cone. So the cone theorem says that this Kleiman-Mori cone can be written in this way. Oh no. So this positive part and the negative part, which can be written in this way. So this is the extremal rays. Okay, so yesterday I gave you two very basic examples, and today I'll give you a little bit more examples. So first one is the abelian surface case. In this case, the cone looks very simple. So actually, in general, abelian varieties has no rational curves. So A has no rational curves. Okay. So this holds in any dimension. So the proof is very easy. If this abelian variety contains a rational curve, that means we have this embedding. Then take an Albanese variety. So the Albanese map, this map should factor through this Albanese map. And the Albanese variety is abelian variety. And in this case, this is actually the Jacobian of P1, which is just a point. Okay, so this map is actually the point, so it's a contradiction. Okay, so we don't have any rational curves, and moreover, in the surface case, by adjunction formula, we can calculate this self-intersection number, okay. But as we have seen, abelian surface has quadratic dimension 0, so this part vanishes. So basically, this is 2g minus g, and since it has no rational curves, this is bounded by 0. So there is no negative curves. Yes. Ah, sorry. Yes. A curve C in A. Okay, so in conclusion, the cone looks like this. So we say, in this case, we say that this Mori cone is a round cone. We don't have any extremal part, right? So we only have this positive part, and it looks like this round. Okay, so most of the points are not rational points. those are irrational points in this case. Okay. So this is far from the examples that I gave you yesterday. And yes.
C squared,
yes. So now A is an abelian surface and C is a curve, so this is a self-intersection number of the curve. Okay, so okay, is it clear? Okay, so now the second example is cubic surfaces. So cubic surfaces. So so S is a hypersurface defined by a degree 3 polynomial. And actually we have another description. So this is the blow up of 6 general points in P2. Right? So in this way we can get a Delpechu surface, and then we can choose a suitable embedding, and then the image is like this. Okay, so we have this. Then it is very well known that there are 27 lines. So yes, so if we take 6 general points, then this cubic is smooth. Then we know that there are 27 lines on it. Right? Then we have a very explicit geometric meaning of those 27 lines. So first, since we took 6 blow-ups, there are 6 exceptional curves. And actually in the cubic surface case, line is nothing but -1 curves. Right? So this is one kind of exercise problem in Hartshorne's book. And so there are 6 exceptional curves, 6 minus 1 curves, and there are 15 minus 1 curves coming from the, okay, so here is P2, and we take 6 points, so we have 6 lines above, and if there is a line passing through those 2 points, then the strict transform should be -1 curve, right? So there are 15 of them. Transform of lines through 2 of them. That means this. Okay. And plus, I think everybody knows that 5 points in a plane determines a conic, right? So by this, we have 6 more -1 curves, so 6 conics. So strict transforms of conics passing through 5 points. And they are all -1 curves on these cubic surfaces. Okay, so in this case, the Kleiman-Mori cone is generated by those 27 lines. So since they are -1 curves, they are rational curves with negative self-intersection number. That means now we don't have this positive part, and we only have this extremal rate part. And those are generated by lines, Li's, and this 7. Okay, so Picard number is, because Picard number is 7, this space lies in this 7-dimensional real vector spaces. Okay. So of course the basis of this seven dimensional vector space is like this. The basis is any hyperplane section. And those exceptional curves, I'll just say L1 through L6. Okay, so exceptional curves are denoted by Li's. Then this strict transform of lines can be written in this way. Since we denote the hyperplane section by H, this can be written in this way. Li Lj, right? And the conic can be described in this way. 2h minus L1, L2, x plus Li. Right? So we can completely understand those nef cones. The notation is bad, but maybe I should put tilde here. Okay. So one remark in this example is that, as you see, the shape of Mori cone is completely different from the previous one. So actually, in fact, later, I'm not sure yet, but if time permits, I'm going to talk about Mori dream surfaces. So in general, any Fano varieties are Mori dream spaces. And every Mori dream spaces has special property on this nef cone. I mean Mori cone. So the Mori cone is always a rational polyhedral. Okay. So cubic surface is a very well known Fano variety in dimension 2. So the nef cone should be a rational polyhedra. And we describe the rational polyhedra in this way. Okay, so in this respect, abelian varieties are kind of opposite variety to the Mori dream space. Okay. So here the cone looks like this. Completely polyhedra. Okay, so this is the remark on the previous lecture. And today I'm going to talk about surface singularities. So my plan is as follows. First, I'm going to talk about this contractibility, T of curves on surfaces. Okay. So today, So today I'm going to talk about some historical things rather than the MMP itself. And then I'm going to review the classical notions of surface singularities. And then I'm going to talk about the singularities in MMP. And I'm going to close this lecture by giving a remark on the discrepancy, which was defined by Song Lak yesterday, and which is very important invariant of the singularity. So I'm going to give you the remark on this discrepancy. Okay, so first I'm going to talk about this contractibility. So of course we know a very powerful contractibility criterion by this, right? Because of this cone theorem and contraction theorem presented by Seong-Lak Choi yesterday, we know the contractibility criterion. But this is quite recent, so today I'm going to talk a little about the history. So actually, I gave you one more contractibility criterion yesterday. This is Castel-Nouveau, right? So yesterday, this theorem was written twice, but I'm going to write it again. So the statement is any minus one curve on a smooth surface can be smoothly contracted. Meaning that it can be contracted to a point, and the point is smooth. Point is a smooth point. Okay, this is a famous and well-known Castel-Nouveau's contractibility criterion. And I asked some very naive question. So this is a minus one. So what happens for any other n curves? It's a very naive question. So by Mumford, it's an old paper, it's now more than 50 years ago. So the statement is like, if we have a divisor E, and EI is an irreducible component of E, okay, so assume that E is contractible. Then by using those irreducible component, we can associate this intersection matrix, right? So by taking this intersection number, we can form a matrix. And this matrix is negative definite. So if it is contractible, then the intersection matrix should be negative definite. So for this question, n should be negative. Okay? So the first case, n is minus one case, is the Castel-Nouveau's contractibility. And before going on, I'm going to have a remark on this. So the converse is in general not hold. So converse holds in some special cases, like in the complex analytic spaces. Okay, so if we have a negative definite configurations of curves, then it is contractible, but once we contract it, then the resulting surface is in general not anymore a projective surface. It is only a complex analytic space. So this is proven by Grauert. And similarly, it holds in the stack. So algebraic spaces, it is true. Stacks. So in general, in the projective surface category, the converse does not hold. Yes, so I'm going to talk about the R-team.
Is the Mumford case all complex surface case? Because you consider project, then it's Hodge index theorem.
Yes, the proof is actually Hodge index theorem, so it is over C.
So, but using projective motion projective?
I don't remember, but what it holds in general. I mean, I don't know. Grauert did everything, but I'm not sure. Okay, so as Professor Yonglam Lee said, Artin did a very good work on this. So these are one of the first papers of Artin, so maybe this gave him the idea of Artin stacks, I'm not sure. So the statement is like this. The converse hold under an additional assumption. So numbers holds if, in addition, this is quite, we don't need this exact statement, but for any cycle, positive cycle supported on E, this arithmetic genus is at most zero. Okay. So this intersection matrix is negative definite, and any effective cycle supported on this divisor has at most zero arithmetic genus. Then the converse holds. It is contractible in the projective category. So the statement is if S is normal projective, then the contraction S bar. So it is the contraction. So is S bar. So for a normal projective surface, if we contract this kind of divisor E, I mean negative definite and this condition, then the resulting surface is projective. Now we can guarantee the projectiveness of the contraction. So in this case, actually it is equivalent to saying that S bar has a rational singularity. So it is also proven by RT. Okay. So in short, we can only guarantee the projective contractibility for the rational singularity case. So it is not very necessary, but I'll just give you the definition of the rational singularity. So it is rational singularity if this, so let F be the resolution map, then S is zero. Okay, this is the definition. So I'm just writing a little bit informally because this is not very needed, but this is what happened. Okay, so for rational singularities, we know the projective contractibility. But for non-rational singularities, this problem is very hard, actually. So for elliptic singularities or higher genus singularities, it is very hard to determine if the contracted surface is projective or not. Okay, so I'm saying this because some of the low canonical singularities are not rational. Okay. So this was some history. And now I'm going to talk about some classical notions of surface singularities. This will be the one of the most important part of today's lecture. So surface singularities. Okay, so first I'm going to review some classical notions of surface singularities. So the first one is Duval singularity. I guess everybody knows the classification of those singularities, but I want to review what's going on here. So actually there are several nicknames of this Duval singularity. It is called rational double points. Yes, I'm going to explain the meaning later. And also it is called ADE singularities. And rational Gorenstein singularity. And as Songrak remarked yesterday, this is canonical singularities. So this is the notion in MMP. Okay. So the classification is like this. We use this symbol to denote the singularities. Okay. So these are all 2-by singularities. So the defining equation of the singularity is this one. And for each of the equations, you can check that it has only one singular point at the origin. And if you do some work, then you can get the resolution graph. And the resolution graph looks like this. Precisely the ADE thinking diagrams. And here, vertex means an exceptional divisor. And this edge means that those exceptional divisors are meeting at one point. I don't know how to say, but yeah, so this is a dual graph of this configuration. Okay, and all the self-intersection numbers are -2. Okay, since these singularities are defined by only one equation, it is also called a hypersurface singularity. Okay, so it's also rational hypersurface singularity. Okay, so one good property of this is that I'm going to prove this later, but this has a Prepont resolution. So for this singularity, if we take a minimal resolution, then the resolution is Prepont. That means the pullback of Ks is Ks tilde. So it is Prepont resolution. So in terms of the MMP, this means that all the coefficients are zero. This is why we get this canonicity here. And as you see here, actually by doing some linear change of coordinate, this can be written in this way too. And you see that the multiplicity at the origin is always 2. So this is why this is double point. And all these are rational singularities, so I put rationalities here. And by this Krepant property, this is a Gorenstein singularity. So we have this classification. Okay. So this is very well known class of surface singularities. And I'm afraid that everybody knows this, but I want to review that. So one remark is this: all these rational double points are actually quotient singularities. So I want to give you one example. So A1 is a quotient singularity. So we define a groove action Z mod 2 on A2, and the action is as follows. For a point U, V on A2, the action sends this point to -U - V. Okay. Then from this action, we get a map from By yes. So a square mod G. Okay, and you can easily see that the G invariant functions are. See, so U square, V square, and U times V, right? It's very easy to check this. So the invariant functions are actually generated by those three. So U square, V square, U times V. Okay, and by saying, let's say U square to be X, V square to be Y, UV to be Z. Then there are one relation between those three monomials. So the relation is Z square minus XY. Right? So this equation is precisely the equation given here when n is 1. Right? So this is the A1 singularity, actually. Okay. So in this way, in general, this can be a little bit complicated, but we can always interpret those singularities in terms of this quotient action. In terms of actions and its quotient. Okay, so rational double points are quotient singularities. So I'm going to talk about quotient singularities from now on. So actually this was remarked by Songrak Choi yesterday. So these singularities are locally defined by the action of a finite group on C2. So I'm going to fix the phase field to be C. So here G should be for some finite group G in GL to C without quasi reflections. Okay, so we want to have an isolated singularity, so we need to consider the groups without quasi reflections. So this is nothing but so G has 1 as an eigenvalue. We call it a quasi reflection, and we don't want to have that. Okay. Because in this case, yes. So this is the definition, and there is a complete classification on this quotient singularities. So I'm going to give you the result of the classification. Yes, finite group. So finite group action. Okay, one example is that one. Okay, so right. So in this way, rational double points are characterized by the quotient singularities with C finite group. It's a quotient singularities, but it's a finite subgroup of SL2C. So it's a much smaller class of quotient singularities. Okay, so before giving a full classification of quotient singularities, I want to remark on the cyclic quotient singularity case, which is very important. So so every quotient singularity is either cyclic or non-cyclic. So cyclic means nothing but the group here is a cyclic group, like Z over 2 there. Okay, so since it is a cyclic group, the group is of this form, right? So the action is given by this. For a point x comma y, we send it to epsilon x comma epsilon to the a y. Okay. Here epsilon is primitive nth root of unity. And a and n are relatively prime. Okay. So of course there are more actions by coming from these groups, but actually this action can be linearized. So every action can be written in this way. Okay. So for this singularity, the notation is just like this: 1 over n, 1 comma a singularity. Okay, so there are three items here. So n is nothing but the order of the group, and 1 a here describes the action of this group in C2, on C2, okay, 1 comma A. This describes the action. Okay, so this cyclic quotient singularity can be completely characterized by those two numbers, N and A. Okay, so the known result is the resolution graph is just a chain of rational curves. So this is the dual graph, and the resolution graph itself is like this. So P1, P1, P1. And we have self-intersection numbers, minus N1, minus N2, and so on. Now, okay. The dual graph, the vertex has weights like minus N1 through minus NL. Okay, so as you see, the if n is 2, then we have this quotient singularity case. Then we have 1 minus 2 curves in the resolution graph, as you see there. Okay. So this A1 singularity is 1 over 2, 1, 1 singularity. Okay. So by looking at this resolution graph, we can immediately write down the intersection matrix. So it should be symmetric, and the diagonals have the weights as its entry. And the adjacent rational curves have 1 intersection numbers. And the other entries of the matrix is 0. Okay, so this is the intersection matrix of the exceptional divisors of this singularity. Okay, so actually the essential informations are on this diagonal. Okay, actually there is a correspondence to a so-called Hilgebrook-Jung continuum fraction. I'll use this notation. So this is nothing but the finite negative continuous fraction. Okay. So since each ni is an integer, if we do the computation, then we get a rational number. Then it is known that the rational number is a over n, n over a. And this n and a are precisely the one in the action, in the notation, 1 over n, 1 comma a. Okay. Actually, proving this is very kind of fun, just a linear algebra. And since this cyclic quotient singularities are the singularities appearing in the toric varieties, so sometimes it is called a toric singularity. So toric singularity. Okay. So actually there are many interesting topological things around this material, but I'm not going to talk about it. And now I'm going to give you the summary of the quotient singularities. So Briscoe almost 50 years ago, he has completely classified the quotient singularities. In other words, all the finite subgroups of C, subgroups of GL2C. So, all finite subgroup G. Okay, so before describing it, I'm going to adopt one notation. So there is a notion of triangle singularity. Triangle singularity. So by this I mean a singularity whose resolution graph is of this form. Okay, so I will use this notation. So B is the self-intersection number of the central component, and P prime, and P is the this part. Okay, so here this is a chain of rational curves. So this part itself is a resolution graph of a cyclic quotient singularity. So it can be described by some two numbers, right? So if this is a resolution graph of this singularity, then we use this P and P prime here, and similarly for the others. This is 1 over Q prime. Over R prime, right? Okay, so this seven number describes this triangle singularities. Okay, then the classification by Briscoe is this one. So so the resolution graph of quotient singularities are of the following form. The first one is the cyclic. So this is like this one. And the others are PQR singularities with this condition. For R is greater than 1. Okay. So actually, in this case, the corresponding groove is non-cyclic. non-cyclic groups, but this one. Okay, so this is a simple arithmetic. So to have more than one in this summation, the choices are like this: 2, 2, and n, and n is arbitrary, and 2, 3, 3, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 5. Okay, these are all. Otherwise, you will have smaller number than one.
What is going to classify the all resolution graph of singularity? But did we really classify all finite groups which can come in?
Yes. He actually did many things. So he classified all the finite groups.
In the cyclic case, Zn case, only you have only one type, but for example, you have chosen Tn.
Yes. Yeah, actually, there are two different types. And he classified all the groups.
All groups.
Yes. And you can find the groups in his paper, although it is written in German. But
so maybe he found the group corresponding to the graph, but I'm not sure he really proved the whole possible groups.
Okay, maybe I'm wrong, but because it is written in German, but as far as I know, he did everything. So after that, one of his students, Riemann Schneider, he has found all the defining equations of each of the singularities too. Okay. As a remark, so if it is not a rational double points, it contains many defining equations, so they are not hypersurface singularities in general. Okay, so actually these are interesting. So here the corresponding group is cyclic group, and here the corresponding group is a binary dihedral group, and here binary tetrahedral group, binary octahedral group, and binary icosahedral group. So it is quite deeply related to the platonic solid and so on. Okay. So for example, let me draw some resolution graph corresponding to this. So this, because this 2, 3, 3, here we have arbitrary central component B. Since one wing is 2, the only choice is minus 2. And for 3, there are two choices. One is minus 2, minus 2, and the other one is just minus 3. Okay. Minus 3. So these are all the possibilities from this condition. Okay. I mean, to have 2 or 3 here, then A is, if n is 3, then there are two choices for A, 1 or 2. Then the corresponding continuous fraction should be 2, 2 or 3. Okay, this is how we get. So for, as an exercise, you may try to write down all the resolution graph for 2, 3, 5. Okay, so if B is 2, this is nothing but the E6 there, right? So here you see that the rational double points are very special class of this quotient singularities. Okay. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, then now I'm going to talk about the singularities coming from MMP. So yesterday, Songlak defined the singularities in MMP. So they are terminal, canonical, log terminal, and log canonical. Okay, so there are four classes of singularities, and actually there is a strict inclusion like this. Okay, so so classifying all the three terminal singularities in dimension three was one of the main steps in Mori's original proof of MMP. Nowadays we do not use it, but this was original work of Mori. So as Songlak remarked yesterday, in the surface case, the terminal singularity corresponds to a smooth point, and canonical is nothing but the eight rational double points. So they are all the canonical surface singularities, and loop terminal singularities are just quotient singularities. This was first proved by Kawamata. And low canonical singularities, he didn't talk about the classification yesterday, so I'm going to give you the classification. So for the surface low canonical singularities, the resolution graph is classified. The form is known. So there are several classes. So surface low canonical singularities. So first one is simple elliptic singularity. This means that the resolution graph is, just one curve, which is elliptic. So it's minus n. Okay. So the resolution graph is just one elliptic curve, smooth elliptic curve. So this is not a rational singularity. This is a simple elliptic singularity. So if we contract it, then sometimes it's not projective surface anymore. Okay. There are many such examples. And the other class is cusp singularity. So this is not the cuspidal cubic curve in the plane. So the resolution graph is the cycle of rational curves. Okay, rational curves forming a cycle. This. Okay, so also we have this self-intersection numbers, and they should be negative, and so on. So those two singularities are elliptic singularities. So if we contract a cusp singularity, then also we cannot obtain a projective surface in general. And these cusp singularities are typically arising in the Hilbert modular surfaces. Okay. And the others are all rational singularities. So the first one is this one. So until here, there are only three wings. But now there are four wings outside this chain. Okay. So those the last components have self-intersection minus 2, and the inside components have no restriction in general. Okay, and the others are of that type. So TPQR with 1 over P plus 1 over Q plus 1 over R is exactly 1. Okay, so it's kind of a limit of this inequality. So actually the possibilities are very small. So 2, 3, 3, 2, 3, 3, 2, 4, 4, and 2, 3, 6. These are all the possibilities. And by you can completely write down all the possible resolution graph as we did here. And the last class is torsion singularity. Okay. So the low canonical surface singularities, which are not log terminal, are those singularities. So in general, if we do something in the log terminal the varieties with log terminal singularities, then it works very well actually. And for log canonical singularities, sometimes it does not work very good because of those elliptic singularities. Usually for those singularities, there is not much problem, but for elliptic singularities, it causes some problems. Okay. And I have only 3 minutes now, and okay. I'm going to, what should I do for 3 minutes? Okay, I'll give you one example. To show how to calculate the discrepancy. Okay, so discrepancy. Okay, so first case. Just consider 1 over n, 1, 1. Okay, this is a quotient singularity, and the corresponding resolution graph is just, okay, so this singularity is one singularity here, and the resolution graph is minus n curve. Okay, this is our situation. Then we want to calculate the discrepancy. So yesterday, Song-Lak Choi defined the discrepancy. So let's say this is surface S, and the minimal resolution is S tilde. Then upper star KS plus AE. And the discrepancy is A. So I'm going to compute the discrepancy A now. Okay, so it's actually very easy. So just take an intersection with E. Then, okay, E plus A E square, okay? And by adjunction, this is nothing but 2G minus 2 minus E square. So in this case, this is a rational curve, and since self-intersection is minus N, we have N minus 2 here. And this part, first part is 0, and here we get N, minus N. Okay, so we have this equality. By this, we get A is minus n, n minus 2. Okay? So this is minus 1 plus 2 over n. So you see here, by assumption, n is at least 2. So this is always bigger than minus 1. So you can double check that this is a KLT singularity here. And if n is 2, that means this is 1 over 2, 1, 1, which is A1 singularity. And in this case, you see that the discrepancy is 0. This means that A1 singularity is a canonical singularity. Okay, since time's up, I'm stuck here. Thank you.